Eugene from the parish of Eastbourne, from Christ the King and St. Joachim's. Very welcome. Good to have you over. Eugene, we are the seminarian on placements in Eastbourne Hospital. And I'd also very much like to welcome the Dean of the Deanery of Eastbourne and St. Leonard's, Father Kevin Drake, and he has a pastoral message to read from Bishop Richard.
Thank you, Father Simon, and it's lovely to be able to come across from Eastbourne to be with you for the Mass this morning to begin this very special weekend of celebration for the parish. Those are my words, not the bishops. So I'm now going to give you the bishop's message. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the celebration of 130 years of the parish community in Bexhill is a significant moment in the life of the parish. May I assure you all of my prayers as you gather for this significant celebration and take this opportunity to thank you for all that you do for the mission of the church in this part of the diocese. The outstanding example and dedication of so many lay faithful, the life of faith in our families, the ministry of the Rosminians and the priests of the diocese of the years together with the wonderful work of our schools is an inspiration and a sure foundation for all the Lord calls us to do in these present times and into the future. May you all continue to be blessed in the life of faith and witness the gospel. Yours sincerely in Christ, Bishop Richard.
Please stand. We're also offering this Mass for the good estate of Agnes Barghese. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Lord Jesus, you are mighty God and Prince of Peace.
Lord, have mercy.
You are the Son of God and the Son of Heaven. You are the Word made flesh, the splendor of the Father. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
was made known by the message of an angel, made through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary by his passion and cross, be brought to the glory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Thank you. travelled along, they met a man on the road, who said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus answered, foxes have holes, and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Another, to whom he said, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man named Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. He went in and said to her, rejoice, so highly favored. The Lord is with you. She was deeply disturbed by these words and asked herself what this greeting could mean. But the angel said to her, Mary, do not be afraid. You have won God's favor. Listen, you are to conceive and bear a son, and you must name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called Son of Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor, David. He will rule over the house of Jacob forever, and his reign will have no end. Mary said to the angel, but how can this come about, since I am a virgin? The Holy Spirit will come upon you. And the angel answered, and the power of the Most High will cover you with its shadow. And so the child will be holy and will be called Son of God. Know this too, your kinswoman Elizabeth has, in her old age, herself conceived a son. And she, whom people call barren, is now in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible to God. I am the handmaid of the Lord, said Mary. Let what you have said be done to me. And the angel left her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you.
Centered around the Word made flesh, we come to invoke, thank, and praise God. Invocation is a joyful remembrance of the wonders worked by God, making do this in remembrance of me an ongoing participation in Christ's death and resurrection. Thanksgiving prevents us taking for granted the blessings we have received from God. Thanks be to thee, my Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits thou hast given to me, for all the pains and insults you have borne for me. Praise begins the process of sharing in participation at the altar enable us to be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. The liturgy is the work of the priests, deacons, and people together. We, your servants and your holy people, offer to God's glorious majesty from the gifts that he has given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. And as the Second Vatican Council stressed in its constitutions, the Mass should be sung, especially the psalms and the antiphons, themselves grounded on sacred scripture. And as has been attributed to St. Augustine, he who sings well prays twice. And what does the parish pray for? Well, many and various things, but Our Lady shows it is for the courage to consent to the word, to be of service to God. But of course, service without love of God, well, it's merely a hobby. And at worst, it might be we brought it over others. Our service must always be of love of God. And genuine service includes saying yes to proclaiming the gospel in and out of season, knowing they are the words of eternal life. They are an expression of God's own love for humanity that he wishes to save. It is also a saying no to sin, which can only separate us from God's love, preventing us flourishing as a child of God. In the Mass, the Church repeats the angel's greeting at the beginning of the Gospel to announce it, and again at the beginning of the Eucharistic prayer. The Lord being with you is an affirmation that Christ is present with us, filling our soul. And if we've dealt with our sin and opened our hearts to grace, the Lord will take shape in us, making us also full of grace. Surely this elicits the same response as Mary. My soul magnifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Saviour. So when we are dismissed and told to go, we pass on our joy of encountering the Lord and so magnifying his presence to the world. So what does the next 130 years look like? Answers please on the postcard. It's of course impossible to tell, but history shows us it will be a mixture of faithfulness and infidelity. When we are faithful, we will enjoy God's blessing. It's not quite the same as happiness. And we will also enjoy prosperity. And that's not the same as having lots of money. Instead, it is a clarity in perceiving who God is, that he is present to us, and that our identity is understood only in reference to him and his plan for us. It's been said, if you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans. The Acts of the Apostles remind us to remain in communion with apostolic faith. Gathered in the upper room with Mother Church, we persevere in prayer together, with Our Lady, of course, whom the disciples made room for her in their home. 500 years ago, when the Feast of Our Lady of the Rosary was instituted, we remember how Christianity was at risk from invasion from the Ottomans. The Christian fleet greatly outnumbered, but the night before the battle, the people of Rome went through the streets, holding the fleet in prayer, praying especially the Rosary, and they attribute their victory to Our Lady's intercession. Remember, on paper, we should have went out. Today's battle, and the battle of the next period, it's not a naval one, but it is a real battle of the souls. To exclude Christianity from our society will not bring that secular humanism that most people want. Instead, it will open the door for Islam to take hold in our country. In the next 130 years, we must recapture our tradition. We must cherish and hand on the lives of the saints, the church's devotion. The liturgy needs to be celebrated with full faith and devotion. All these things are an example of Christ's presence and our increase in holiness. And if we do all those things, it will leave the next 130 years in very good stead indeed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things are made.
So that the Mass, charity, and prayer may remain at the centre of parish life. Lord, in Your Mass. For those who, for any reason, are on the periphery of our communities, may we hold them in our prayer, visit them, and be ready to welcome them home. Lord, in your mercy. For the past clergy and laity who serve our parish mission and who have died. May they claim the reward promised to them in heaven. Lord, in your mercy. May our Lady of the Rosary pray with us and for us as we say,
Amen. Amen.
for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
Amen.
Let us pray.
We pray, O Lord our God, that just as we proclaim in this sacrament the death and resurrection of your Son, so they may partake us in his suffering, we may also merit to share in his consolation and his glory, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
So our celebrations of our 130th anniversary are just really beginning. So we have the Eucharist to feed our soul. Thank you to all those who have participated this morning, especially those who are good by the music, by the welcome, reading, service from also all of you who come from across the parish, not just any one group, which is fantastic. But all the lovely flowers we have to celebrate our anniversary, so thank you as always to those. Thank you for Kevin and Dean joining us and Eugene as well. There's a lot of work been going on behind the scenes by the pastoral team and the parish office. I think this weekend on a great joy. So after this Mass, come into the hall, because there's a lovely lunch waiting for you. So lots of nice food to come and lunch. Please do come and eat it. Now don't forget that our celebrations continue with our Sunday Masses, but also tomorrow, 2 p.m. at St. Martha's Hall, we have our children's Rosary event. So children and families come along to Mass and learn how the Rosary is so important to our Christian faith and to our parish. It's a practical discovery session, so we're going to do a Rosary as well and get some refreshments. And then at 4 p.m. in St. Mary Magdalene Church, we have our family event, Let Your Light Shine. Lots of different groups from the parish will be here in St. Mary Magdalene Church to tell us about who they are, what their charism is, and how you can be involved. So it's a really good opportunity to find out more about the parish and what we're all to. In between the 9 a.m. Mass and the 11 a.m. Mass in St. Mark's, we have our fair trade breakfast, and you can see the signs there to remind us of how important fair trade is to our parish identity. And then we'll finish off in St. Mary Magdalene Church with adoration from 6 p.m. Evening prayer to the church at 6:30. So a great weekend of events. I'm sure there is something there for everyone. The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. Bow down for the blessing. May God, who through the childbearing of the Blessed Virgin Mary, will in his great kindness to redeem you, redeem the human race, please to enrich you with his blessing.
Amen.
And may you know always and everywhere the protection of her, from whom you have been found worthy to receive the offer of life.